All right. So solutions, last time we went over how to calculate or, you know, how to measure the concentration of solutions, different ways of measuring the concentration. And after that, we discussed about solubility, like solubility of solids in liquids and solubility of gases in liquids. Okay. And how they vary and everything. Now we look at, you know, some properties and things of liquid solutions. Or, you know, solutions of liquids mixed in liquids. Okay. So first thing is, what do you mean by vapor pressure?
If you have a liquid that is volatile, mm-hmm. so the gaseous, the pressure exerted by the vapor state of the same liquid, like if you have water, then water vapor jo hai, the pressure that it applies on the surface of the liquid, like the interface, mm-hmm. The pressure that is applied there by the vapor of water on the water surface is called the vapor pressure.
Yes, exactly. So Jasleen also said, so pressure exerted by the vapor phase on the liquid surface. So where is this vapor coming from? So when you just have random liquid sitting there, you have a closed vessel of liquid. We discussed this last year at some point as well. So evaporation is like a constant process. So evaporation is always taking place. The only thing it depends on is temperature and of course like the nature of the liquid. So when evaporation takes place, some molecules of the liquid are going into vapor phase. Now, when they are in vapor phase, that's basically gaseous state. Gases exert pressure in all directions. So the pressure exerted by the vapor phase on the liquid surface, that's called vapor pressure. So basically pressure exerted by the vapor. Okay. So now when you take a solution of two liquids, now,
how does the pressure change from liquid to liquid, the pressure exerted? I don't understand how it changes according to the liquid.
Okay, so now vapor pressure of a liquid depends on how many molecules of the liquid have evaporated. So now let's say you have water, like a liquid one water. And you have another liquid, let's take another liquid, let's say acetone. Okay. Now, are the properties of water same as the properties of acetone? Now, I don't mean chemical properties. No. Consider the physical properties, you know, like the...
No.
They're not the same, right? Now, water may... you have hydrogen bonding at a higher degree as compared to what you have in acetone. So in which case would you find more number of molecules evaporating from the liquid into vapor?
Acetone.
So that's why acetone is like, we call it acetone being more volatile. So it goes into gaseous state a lot more. So if you have more molecules of acetone in the vapor state than your water molecules in the vapor state, kiska vapor pressure will be greater?
Acetone.
Acetone ka vapor pressure is going to be greater just because of the fact that there's more number of molecules there. So that's why nature of the liquid also affects its vapor pressure also. That's why it's different.
If there are equal number of molecules, the pressure will be the same, right? Regardless of whether it's water or acetone.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Cool. So now coming to solutions, vapor pressure of solutions. Now solutions mein kya ho raha hai? You have two different liquids mixed together, right? So let's say you have liquid 1 and liquid 2 or liquid A and liquid B. Now liquid A ke molecules are also evaporating going into the vapor phase. Liquid B ke molecules are also going into the vapor phase. All right. So both of them have established like their own equilibriums. Both of them have their own vapor pressure. Okay. So Yeah, binary solution of two volatile liquids has two components A and B. Now, both of them establish their own equilibrium. Now, the total vapor pressure you find just above the solution will consist of like partial pressures of PA and PB, because you have partial pressure associated with liquid A and partial pressure associated with liquid B. Wait, let me just get the whiteboard out. Okay. All right. Okay. So you have a vessel here and there is a solution. Okay. So I'll use two different colors. So this is a solution of A and B. Let A be red and I'll take blue as B. All right. Now in the vapor state just above the liquid surface, you've got molecules of B also. And since A is also in the solution, you've got like molecules or particles of A also. So this is the interface. Okay, so now total pressure P will be equal to pressure due to particles of A and pressure due to particles of B. So basically this is the partial pressure of A plus the partial pressure of B. Okay, now what do you think will the partial pressure of each liquid depend on? Will partial pressure of A be equal to, you know, if you had will partial pressure of A be equal to the vapor pressure of A if you had like a pure A liquid?
No, ma'am.
So what is it going to depend on?
So there is a
volume of the liquid, right, present in the container.
Volume is one thing. Now we're saying the pressure will depend on the number of molecules that are going into the vapor phase, right? So in what other way can you phrase it, Ritvik, other than volume, which would be a more accurate measurement to take?
Number of moles.
So yeah, as Ria, Jasleen, Ananya have mentioned, so basically the partial pressure of any component, PI, let's say, I can be A or B, is basically depending on the mole fraction of that particular component. Okay, so this is basically coined by, or this was stated by Raoult. So he stated his law, Raoult's law, which basically states that at a particular temperature, the for a solution of volatile liquids, so when you have two volatile liquids, basically both the liquids should be able to, should undergo evaporation. The partial vapor pressure of each component is directly proportional to its mole fraction present in the solution. So this is what Raoult had mentioned. So this is the mathematical form of Raoult's law. If the mole fraction was equal to one, it means that like the all of the molecules present in the solutions are of a single component only. Then what will the partial pressure be equal to on top of the solution?
Sorry, what, ma'am?
So if the mole fraction, or let's say like if chi A, mole fraction of A is equal to one, then what does it mean? Like what is there in the solution here?
That would mean that there is like only molecules of A present.
Yeah, so it is completely going to be molecules of A alone, right? Then what can you say about the vapor pressure on top of the liquid?
It should be directly proportional to 1. So
that's, see, if you have a clear,
so that would be the pure vapor pressure that is exerted by the vapors of A.
Yes. So let the vapor pressure of A be denoted by P naught, and let the vapor pressure of B, so if you had pure B, let that particular vapor pressure be denoted by P naught B. So according to according to Raoult's law, the partial pressure is directly proportional to the mole fraction, right? So that we can be rewritten as partial pressure of A will be equal to mole fraction of A into the vapor pressure of pure A, and partial pressure of B will be equal to mole fraction of B into the pure the vapor pressure of pure B. So the total P total, the total vapor pressure above a certain solution, if you substitute the values here, P total will be equal to PA plus PB, partial sum of the partial pressures. So this I will write it as mole fraction of A into the vapor pressure of pure A plus mole fraction of B into the vapor pressure of pure B. Okay, so this is like an important relation that you will use in a lot of problems, in a lot of sums. Okay. 2 points here. One is Raoult's law. The statement exactly, it says at a given temperature, like temperature should be fixed constant. It should not vary. Like why do we have to specify at a given temperature? Like why won't it be the case for any temperature?
Ma'am, because like if the temperature is fluctuating, then with the change in temperature, the activity and kinetic energy of the gaseous molecules will also change, which will, yes, change the pressure.
Absolutely. So you need to fix the temperature at any given temperature for a solution of two or more volatile liquids. So you're taking two volatile liquids in solution. The partial vapor pressure of any one component is directly proportional to its mole fraction in the present in the solution. So this is the statement of Raoult's law, and this would be the mathematical expression or equation of Raoult's law. And if you want to take away the proportionality sign, if you want to make it into an equation, so basically partial pressure will be equal to mole fraction into the vapor pressure of the pure component. Okay. So now that you have this, there are many number of ways where this can be modified. I'm just clearing this. So we've got total pressure, like total vapor pressure over a solution is equal to xA into P naught A plus xB into P naught B. Now, if you had only A and B in the solution, obviously if it's a binary solution of just A and B, what can you say about sum of their mole fractions?
1.
It's going to be equal to 1. That's going to be total. So this I can write it as P total is equal to XA into P naught A plus 1 minus XA into P naught B. So just rearrange this, I get chi A into P naught A plus P naught B minus XA into P naught B, which will be equal to partial pressure of B plus partial pressure of A minus partial pressure of B, or vapor pressure of A minus vapor pressure of B into mole fraction of A. So this is P total. So if you know the mole fraction of A, you can measure the, like, you can still get the total vapor pressure if you know the vapor pressure of the individual components. And if you know the individual mole fraction of B also instead of A, then the equation can be modified. So instead of substituting for XB, you substitute for XA and you get a different form of this equation. Okay. So from the mathematical equation, of course, if you had to draw a graph, what would be the form of the graph of the total vapor pressure versus the concentration?
It would be a straight line.
It's going to be a straight line, linear. Because this is kind of looking like y equal to mx plus c, right? So y being the total vapor pressure, x being the mole fraction, and m is, of course, it's going to be a constant because vapor pressure of pure A, pure B are all constants, and c is also another constant. Okay, so it's going to be a straight line. So this is what it's going to look like. So this is, we are combining two graphs in one. So we'll be plotting the graph with respect to mole fraction of A and also with respect to mole fraction of B. Okay, so what is the range of values that any mole fraction can take? Is it 0 to infinity or is it bound
0
by
to 1?
0 to 1.
0 to 1, because this is mole fraction, right? So either you'll have 0, or if all of the moles are belonging to the same same component, mole fraction is going to be equal to 1. So let me just make this clearer. So x-axis. So if I take mole fractions on the x-axis, so we'll start with, if I have completely only A, and on the other end, what will be the mole fraction of A? You have 0. So when I have completely only A, what will be the mole fraction of B over here?
0.
0. And if I have none of A, what will be the mole fraction of B over here?
1.
And we'll be plotting the vapor pressure on the y-axis. So when mole fraction of A equal to 1, what will the vapor pressure of A be equal to?
PA.
P naught A. It's going to be equal to mole vapor pressure of pure A. So this point will be P naught A, and P naught A, and what will be the vapor pressure of B in this situation on the extreme left?
0.
Yeah, that's going to be equal to 0 here. Yes. Now coming to the flip side, when mole fraction of A is equal to 0, what will be the pressure, the vapor pressure? Come on, guys. What will be the vapor pressure of A?
0.
0, yeah. And of B?
P naught B.
Let's say it's somewhere over here. This is P naught of B. So if you look at the variation of the partial pressure of B, it is changing from 0 to P naught B, depending on the concentration of B. And similarly, depending on the concentration of A or the mole fraction of A, that is also changing from zero to P naught A. Okay. Now, P total will be equal to P naught A, partial pressure of A plus partial pressure of B. That's going to be another straight line which varies like this. Okay. So this is the line for P total, which is equal to partial pressure of A plus partial pressure of B. So this is the line corresponding to the variation of partial pressure of B, and this is the line corresponding to the variation in partial pressure of A, depending on the concentration. Okay, so this is basically the mathematical, or this is the graphical representation of Raoult's law. Okay, so what can you conclude from the graph? So what can you say about the variation of the partial pressures with respect to the concentration?
Partial pressures increase.
Partial pressure increases with?
Increase
in concentration, yes. And also, what sort of a variation is it? Like linear, exponential, logarithmic, or is it random?
Linear.
Yes. So variation is completely linear. So all of them are straight lines. And and also the total vapor pressure, it can either increase or decrease. Like there is no fixed variation for the total vapor pressure. Like in this case, it is increasing with respect to increase in the concentration of partial pressure of, or increase in the concentration of component B. In this case, okay, depending on this figure, now partial or the vapor pressure of A is less than the vapor pressure of B. Which is the more volatile component, A or B?
I think B is more volatile.
Yes, B is the more volatile component. Okay, now let's look at another situation. Okay, I'll draw a similar graph. But in this case, I'll make A is the more volatile component. So this will be PA, this will be PB. In this case, what is the variation in the total pressure? Is it increasing or decreasing with respect to concentration of B?
It's decreasing.
The total pressure is decreasing.
So how can you decide, or how can you predict the variation of the total vapor pressure? Like what is it depending on? Whether it's increasing or decreasing, is it depending on concentration of A or concentration of B? Like how do you predict, what's the pattern for the total pressure here?
Ma'am, pattern as in?
See, with individual partial pressures, we see a clear pattern that partial pressure of a component increases with the its concentration. Like if XB, or you know, concentration of B is increasing from 0 to 1, partial pressure of B is also like linearly increasing. Same with partial pressure of A. As it increases from 0 to 1, this is increasing. Now, what about the variation in the total vapor pressure? In this case, it is increasing with the concentration of B, But in this case, it is decreasing with the concentration of B. Is there like a particular pattern that you can observe here? Ria has sent in and she has recognized it. Like, that's absolutely right. Yeah. Anybody else also? Any ideas? No? Okay. So what Ria has said is, she says it, the total vapor pressure increases when concentration of the more volatile substance increases. So the total vapor pressure, the variation in the total vapor pressure, depends completely on the concentration of the more volatile substance. So in this case, B is the more volatile substance. So the total vapor pressure, we can see it increasing with the concentration of B. But in this case, since A is the more volatile substance, the total vapor pressure of the solution increases with the concentration of A in this case, or it decreases with the concentration of the less volatile substance. Correct? Understood?
Yes, ma'am.
Cool. So this is the statement, formula, and graph related to Raoult's law. What else do we have? Okay. So from the graphs, what would you say are the what would be minimum value of P total? What does this correspond to? Will it be zero or will it be something else?
Ma'am, looking from the first graph, the minimum value of P total would be P naught A.
Okay. But in the second graph, it is?
P naught B.
In the second graph, the minimum value will be P naught
B. Now, what in the first case, what is P naught A? In the second case, what is P naught B? Huh.
I mean, first case, P naught A is the total partial pressure of pure liquid A.
Yeah. Now, what can you say about A in the first case and B in the second case?
Also the less volatile component.
Yes. So the minimum value that the total vapor pressure can take will be equal to the vapor pressure, the pure vapor pressure of the less volatile substance or the less volatile component. Let's call it component. And similarly, what would be the maximum value that P total can take?
P naught of more volatile component.
Yes. So that would be equal to P naught of the more volatile component. Okay. That's a good point. And we have discussed earlier. So the composition of the vapor phase. So again, this is like an extension of what you guys had studied when we were doing ideal gas also. So the composition of the vapor phase, like in the vapor phase, if you had to find the component of any mole fraction of any particular substance, that is going to be equal to the partial pressure of that substance upon the total vapor pressure. Now, the mole fraction, like the component or the fraction of or the concentration of the component in the vapor phase will not be equal to or will not be same as the concentration in the liquid phase. Okay, so let's not call it chi. Let's give it a different this thing. Let's call it y. So this is the mole fraction in the vapor phase. So you can find the composition of the two substances in the vapor phase also, if you know the composition in the liquid phase, because Pi relates to the mole fraction in the liquid phase into the total vapor pressure. So once you get Pi, like once you get Pa, so Pa upon P total will give you the mole fraction in the vapor phase. Okay. So let's do a couple of problems based on this. Okay. Can I erase this? All of you have noted this down?
One second.
Okay, cool.
Yes, I'm done.
Done? Cool. Clear. So question one. So we'll start with a simple one. So you're given the vapor pressure. So P naught of A is equal to 80 mmHg, and P naught of B is given as 60 mmHg. So what is the total vapor pressure? So find the total vapor pressure when 3 moles of A are mixed with 2 moles of B. Go. Do it quickly. Should be able to finish this in 1 minute, like less than a minute. Ria has already sent in. Ria, what units? Oh, Aryan has also sent in. Both of you have got like wildly different answers. Abhinav also has sent in, and that's another completely different answer. Of all of you guys who sent in, only Abhinav has answered correctly. Okay, you guys have used the relation, this particular relation, right? Like P total will be equal to Ritvik, yes, correct answer, but you also have missed out on your units. Ria, Aryan, Jasmine, and Jasleen, you guys have to check your answers, yes. That's okay. I'll be discussing the solution now. You guys should have done, man. You guys had 2 minutes. So P total will be equal to what relation are you going to use to find the P total?
XA into P naught A plus XB into P naught
A. Absolutely. So P naught A plus the mole fraction of B into P naught B. You're given all of the values. So mole fraction you are given indirectly. Ria has corrected it. What happened, Ria? Where did you make a mistake? Calculation mein tha kya? Or anyway, so what would be the mole fraction of A?
3/5.
3/5, because 3 plus 2, Na upon N total, na mole fraction. into P naught of A is given as 80 plus this would be 2 by 5 into P naught of B is given as 60. So that will be equal to 5 16s, and this will be 12, which would be equal to 48 plus 24, that is equal to 72 mm Hg. This would be the answer. Okay, go with the basics. Yeah, I think you use the other formula, like xa, so p total equal to p naught b plus xa into p naught b minus p naught a, like that other thing which got a little complicated. But yeah, simple. Like this, if you remember this, all other relations are derivations from this. So this would be the like the easiest way to go ahead with. Okay. We'll do another one just like this quickly. Okay, this is slightly twisty. Sorry, second question, Anna. You're given that vapor pressure of pure A, P naught A, is equal to 70 mm Hg at 25 degrees Celsius. It forms a solution with B in which mole fraction of B is given as, it forms a solution with B and mole fraction of A is 0.8. You're given that the vapor pressure of the solution at 25 degrees Celsius is equal to 84 mm Hg.
So they're then P total.
So find P naught B. Yeah. Yeah. Do it now. This time I will see answers from Amla, Siddharth, Jinen also, and Kingshuk. Quickly, again. You gotta use the same equation as earlier. Fadafit, substitute karke to this. Yes, Siddharth. Oh, that must have been.
I wanted to answer. I clicked on raise hand by mistake.
Okay. Type it. Okay, Abhinav has already sent in. Siddharth also has sent in. Both of you, correct answers, you guys. Nice. Good. Well done. Okay, it would be the same thing, right? So P total. So vapor pressure of solution, matlab P total diya hai unhone. Ananya, yes. Correct answer. Riya, yes. Mole fraction of A into P naught A plus mole fraction of B into P naught B. So you're given 84 is equal to mole fraction of A 0.8 into 70 plus, you're not given mole fraction of B, but can you find out what is mole fraction of B?
0.8.
Agar 0.8 is A, total is got to be 1. So 0.2 into, this is what we need to find out, P naught B. Jinen, yes, correct answer. Awesome. Aryan, yes, correct. Good. Most of you have gotten it. So I still haven't gotten from Amla and Ananya. No, Ananya has sent in. Yeah. So Jasmine, Jasleen, Kingshuk, and Ritwik. Let's see if you guys are able to do it before me. Yeah? So 84 is equal to 70 into 0.8 would be 56. Just mean your decimals. Very close, but I think you lost out in the decimals. Plus 0.2 into P naught B. So on rearranging, you get 0.2 into P naught B equal to 84 minus 56. Kitna? So 6 plus 8 is 14. 5 plus 28 hoga. Which means that P naught B is equal to, yes, Amla got it. Good, good stuff. 28 upon 0.2. So that 280 upon 2, that will be equal to 140 mmHg. Yep. So exact same thing, exact same formula, exact same logic. You just have to interpret the question, and then like that also, like half the job I've done it. So mole fraction of B you're not given, but since you're given A, that's going to be 1 minus mole fraction of A. So you get the mole fraction of B also. And substitute karke, it's just mathematics after that. Simple? Okay. All right. So we'll go on to the next topic. Kisi ko aur practice karna hai uspe? You want to do like one problem more? Okay, I'm taking it as a no. I'll be moving forward then. Okay, so this was vapor pressures related to, okay, Aryan is asking something at a higher level. Higher level, I will have to look for it. Mostly it's pretty easy. And then sometimes it is combined with like other this thing. So we'll see. A lot of questions are based on, yeah, it's basically this only, because isse zyada aur kya ho sakta hai? Maybe liquids. I'll look for it by the end of the session, then we'll do it. Okay. Huh. So now we've seen liquid related solutions. Now, what if you have mixed a solid solute in a liquid solvent? Okay, so specifically we're looking at a non-volatile solid solute. Will the vapor pressure of the liquid solvent be affected when you mix a solid in a liquid? So you're mixing?
Yes, ma'am.
Why?
Because like how do I say this? There is going to be solid particles in the liquid, right? That's gonna reduce the surface area. So there will be lesser area for evaporation and thus lower vapor pressure.
Yes. Yes, absolutely. So again, let's say I've got a blue solvent. So this is the solution. Now, when you have pure solution, of course, like, you know, all of the molecules on the surface are available to go into the vapor state. And you are going to have a specific like vapor pressure at which the equilibrium is established. But when you mix solute particles, like non-volatile solid solute. Now, because this is solid, this is not going to go into vapor state. There is no vapor pressure associated with solids, but this is going to occupy this like the surface also, along with all of the spaces inside, which means that enough liquid molecules, or you know, enough solvent molecules are not exposed for them to go into the vapor state. So what do you observe the vapor pressure to be? Like, is it going to increase or decrease? What is going to happen? Yes, just means it's decrease, absolutely. So you're going to observe, yes, lowering of vapor pressure. And this particular vapor pressure, this particular lowering of vapor pressure, so Raoult's law is also applicable to this particular case also when a solid solute is mixed in a liquid solvent, except you don't have two different components. It will be applicable only to the solvent. So the vapor pressure of the solvent will be equal to the P naught, which is vapor pressure of the pure solvent, into the mole fraction of the solvent itself. Okay. So this is like the Raoult's law as applicable to the solid liquid solutions. So it'll not be applicable for solutes. It'll be applicable only on solvents. And of course, the relation is going to be the same. So,
ma'am, one question here.
Mm-hmm.
So if we are increasing the amount of solute here, the vapor pressure will decrease even further, right?
Yeah.
So why is there no like component for the mole fraction, at least for the solute, in the Raoult's law equation?
But there is, no?
Because that's what's going to make a difference, right?
Okay. So what will happen to X1 when you increase the quantity of the solute? Is it not going to change?
It's not going to change. It's not going to change. All right, wait, it's going to. It will change. Yeah, it will decrease.
Because this is mole fraction, right? So remember, this will be equal to n of solvent upon, there is n of solute also involved in this expression, plus n of solvent.
So it's like, even if you add more, the decrease in the mole fraction of the solvent will compensate.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So when you add more solute, n solute is increasing, which means that the denominator is increasing. So the overall fraction decreases when the denominator increases. Okay. So mathematically also it makes sense. And theoretically also it makes sense. Okay. Cool. So this is what is about when solid solutes are liquid, are mixed in liquid solutions. And then we've got, I'll see if we have a problem on this particular section. Just a moment. No, we don't have it like explicitly on this particular concept. Okay. Now coming to the concept of ideal solutions, ideal and non-ideal solutions. Okay. Now, what do you mean by ideal solutions? Like, why do we have a concept of ideal and non-ideal solutions?
To like establish a baseline for comparison, I guess.
But what exactly are you comparing?
Ma'am, it's like comparing, right? If we say one thing is, if we say something is not good enough, we will usually compare it to something, like, right? We have something that is considered good enough so that we, like, you know, make something
just
else,
like
not
ideal gases enough. And real gases. Similarly,
yeah, you can consider that. Yeah.
Yeah, but where exactly is the good versus not good coming from? You know, like what factor are you comparing? And yeah, like your analogy is very right. Your analogy is very good. In it's the same argument in the case of ideal and real gases also. So, like, where is that good versus not good coming from? So, in ideal and real gases, So any gas that follows the ideal gas equation or the ideal gas law across all pressures and temperatures, that is considered to be an ideal gas. And if there is a deviation, then it is considered as a real gas. And we have also observed why real gases are behaving that way, you know, like where is that deviation or what is causing that deviation. Now, similarly, what are ideal solutions? And obviously non-ideal solutions are different from ideal solutions because of, you know, they deviate in some way from ideal solutions. So in this case, what is the this thing? What is the main law or equation that they're supposed to follow? Riya has answered. Very good. So the ones that follow...
They should follow Rawls' law.
Yes, absolutely. And Abhinav, yeah. So ideal solutions are those that follow Raoult's law. Specifically, yeah, so they follow Raoult's law across all concentrations or across the entire range of concentrations. Yes. Okay. And in case they deviate from Raoult's law, then they become non-ideal solutions. So other criteria for identifying ideal solutions are that the enthalpy of mixing, you know, like when you mix both the components of the solution, there is no energy given out or absorbed. And also there is no change in the volume on mixing. No change in volume in means when you mix 500 ml of component A and 500 ml of component B, the total volume is 1 liter. So in the case of non-ideal solutions, it is not exactly 1 liter. It may become 1.01 liters, or it may become 999.94 liters. So there'll be like a slight increase or decrease. So delta V of the mixture will not be equal to zero in the case of non-ideal solutions. But in the case of ideal solutions, this is the case. Yeah, Janine?
Question. Hmm. So the delta change in the volume for a non-ideal solution, will this be caused by a chemical reaction or by physical phenomena, like increasing in the density or whatnot?
It'll be caused by... So no, there won't be a chemical change. But like it, there's not going to be a chemical reaction, but there is some phenomenon happening which is causing the change in volume, change in delta V. And the reason for the existence of ideal versus non-ideal solutions is the same as your reason for the existence of real gas as opposed to ideal gases. So can you guys guess what this reason is? So what is the reason for the existence of non-ideal solutions? Any guesses?
Ma'am, because of some impurities or something?
Think back. I told you the reason for existence of real gases is same as this. Now, why do real gases exist?
Ma'am, the attraction between the solute particles is not...
Yeah, attraction between solute and solvent particles.
Exactly. So Riya has also answered, in short, intermolecular interactions. You know, interaction between molecules of the two components, you know, between the solute and the solvent particles. Okay. So non-ideal solutions do not follow Raoult's law. Like they don't follow across all ranges of concentrations. And also it is observed that delta H of the mixture is not equal to zero and delta V of the mixture is not equal to zero. Okay. Jasmine, yeah, you guys have your Viva, right? Yeah, you can do that. And I'll upload this. You can watch it online. Okay. Cool. And the reason, as most of you have mentioned, is the intermolecular interactions. Now, what happens in the case of, see, what was the graph for Raoult's law in the case of ideal solutions? Like, what was the shape of the graph? They're all going to be straight lines. So this is P total. This is for partial pressure of A, and this is for the partial pressure of B, right? Call it P naught A, P naught B. In the case of non-ideal solutions, if it does not follow linear, let's say this is the ideal case. I'm putting it in a different color. So in the case of non-ideal, there is going to be deviation from the ideal case. So there may be a positive deviation. So when you actually measure the partial pressures, it may be slightly bigger or slightly greater than what has been calculated. It's going to be greater in all the three cases. It's going to look something like this. Or it may be slightly lower than what is calculated as well. So it differs in both the cases. So both kinds of non-ideal solutions exist, where the observed is greater than the calculated and where the observed is lesser than what is calculated as well. And in cases where it is greater than what is calculated, they're said to show positive deviation. And where it is lesser than the, when the observed value is less than the calculated value, they are said to show negative deviation. Okay. All right. Now, can you predict what causes a negative deviation and what causes a positive deviation? So the answer, of course, as you guys had mentioned earlier, it will depend on the intermolecular attractions. Okay. Now, can you predict what causes a positive deviation and what causes a negative deviation? Like, what should your intermolecular interactions look like to get a positive deviation and to get a negative deviation? Let's consider the positive deviation case first. Okay. So positive deviation mein kya ho raha hai? So if this is like your calculated value, actual values are showing to be greater than the calculated value. All right. So if the actual vapor pressures are greater than the calculated vapor pressures, does that indicate that there's a greater level of interaction? Like, is there more intermolecular forces of attraction or is there lesser intermolecular forces of attraction?
I think lesser.
There has to be lesser. So what causes a positive deviation is that, yeah, as Riya says, it's weaker. So the interaction between A and B, so is weaker than the individual interaction that they would have otherwise had. Weaker than the interaction between AA or the interaction between B and B. Now, because the interaction between A and B is weaker, there is nothing that's like pulling them down. They're free to go and, you know, escape as a vapor. So that is why you'll see that the observed vapor pressure is greater than the ideal case. Okay. So this will actually like from this you can actually figure out what can you say about the delta H of the mixture. Is it going to be greater than zero or less than zero? Ria says yes, it will be positive then. Why would it be positive? This is a question for anyone, huh? So Ria said delta H, the enthalpy of mixing the solution is greater than zero, means that it's going to be endothermic in nature. Why is it endothermic? So think back to your chemical bonding. Like if there is a bond being formed between any two species,
So the AA, the AA or BB bond is stronger than the AB bond. So like neither of the components would actually want to separate their own bonds and then create bond with the other species. So to break these bonds of AA and BB, you'll have to provide energy. Exactly. And so to make the solution, you need to like give heat or other forms of energy, which is why it's endothermic.
Yes, very well explained, of course. So AB, like interaction between A and B is weaker than your AA or BB interactions. So you need to break those bonds first so that you can make A and B interact with each other. So you need to put in some energy. Yes, absolutely. So that is why delta H will be greater than zero. And what can you say about the delta V of the mixture? Will this be less than zero? Will this be greater than zero?
Sorry, what, ma'am?
What can you say about the delta V of the mixture?
I can't hear you, ma'am. Hello.
Hello. Am I audible, all of
you?
Yes,
ma'am. Yes, okay. Ma'am, you're audible, ma'am.
Okay. So what would be the, what can you say about the delta V of the mixture? Greater than zero or less than zero?
Delta V is the change in volume?
Yes.
Okay, ma'am. So I think it'll be negative. Like so less than zero.
The total volume will decrease.
No, ma'am, it's positive because some of the components will escape out. So
yeah, some of the components will escape out. That is one way to look at it. Another way to look at it is the interaction between the individual components is stronger, right? So think of it as, you know, let's say there is hydrogen bonding between the components of A and components of B. Okay, so they're all bonded tightly together. Now, these bonds have gotten weaker, which means that they will have some amount of extra space between each of the individual particles. So that is going to slightly increase the volume as compared to your original volume of A plus original volume of B. Yeah, Ananya has also mentioned positive, like the solution might expand after the bonds are broken. Yes. See, if there are bonds like hydrogen bonds or your dipole-dipole interactions or your dipole-induced dipole interactions, like any of the intermolecular bonds between the individual particles, if they've gotten weaker, then there'll be slightly extra space between them because they don't want to be held tightly together. So the overall volume of the mixture also increases, like it expands slightly. This is going to be greater than zero. Okay. So these are like the some of the features of a positive, of non-ideal solutions with positive deviation. Now, what about some examples? Do any of you remember any examples? Can you give some examples of this?
I think sugar and water.
Sugar is a solid solute, no?
Oh, sorry, we are talking about liquid.
Liquid, yeah. So, we want individual interaction between AA and BB to be stronger, right? So, you can think of components that originally might have interactions like hydrogen bonding or dipole-dipole interactions. But
ethanol and acetone.
Addition of the other component should break those. So one of the components will have hydrogen bonding and the other will not have hydrogen bonding. So think of cases like that. As Abhinav said, yes. So ethanol plus acetone is an example. So ethanol has hydrogen bonding because it's got like O and H, or and the H is connected to O. So there's like a large difference in electronegativities. But acetone doesn't have hydrogen bonding. So on adding the acetone molecules to ethanol molecules, like the already existing hydrogen bonds are going to break. So this is gonna break some of those bonds. And any other examples? Like try to remember at least two examples just in case. So basically ethanol with any other, So ethanol.
Non-polar.
Non-polar can be a good example. So you can say ethanol plus cyclohexane is one that people have mentioned. Acetone plus benzene is another. You also given carbon disulfide plus acetone also. So think of one polar plus non-polar. This is going to cover this thing. Okay. All right. Have you guys noted this? Can I clear the screen? Yes, no? Guys?
Noted, ma'am.
Okay. So now coming to non-ideal solutions with negative deviation. So just think of all the corresponding points. So negative deviations, what can you say about the intermolecular interactions or attractions? So the attraction between A and B is going to be
stronger.
Yes, AB is going to be stronger than the individual AA or BB. So consequently, because the attraction is stronger, what will be the observed vapor pressure? So the observed is going to be, will you observe a greater total vapor pressure or lesser total vapor pressure? Yes, so observed as is going to be lesser than this thing. So this is like the crux of the negative deviation. Because the deviation is in the negative side, like it is lesser than this thing, it's called a negative deviation non-ideal solution. And what can you say about the delta H of the mixture? Is it going to form exothermic or endothermic? So it's going to be greater than zero. It's going to be exothermic. Yes, it'll be less than zero. And the change in volume, greater than zero or less than zero?
Less than zero.
Yes, Awesome. Ananya has also sent in. This is going to be less than zero. Cool. So volume will slightly decrease. So which is obvious. So positive deviation may, if we had to look for examples, we look for stuff that already had some sort of bonding and you added in another component which broke those bonds. In this case, you're going to look at components that have an opportunity to form hydrogen bonds or, you know, have those dipole-dipole interactions when they are mixed with each other. So what can be some of the examples in this case? So one example is phenol plus aniline. So phenol is basically benzene ring with an alcohol group and aniline is a benzene ring with a amine group. So it's this is what it looks like. So this is going to be basic in nature. It's got a lone pair of electrons and phenol has this OH group. O is highly electronegative. It's going to pull electrons from hydrogen. So there is a hydrogen bond being formed between the hydrogen here and the lone pair of nitrogen over here. Okay. So that hydrogen bond is going to be stronger than the already existing bonds that are present in phenol. And aniline may, of course, N is not very electronegative as compared to oxygen. So it's going to be like less. Ria is asking, ethanol plus water will be positive or negative deviation? Anyone can answer this? Ethanol plus water is positive or negative? Water already has hydrogen bond. Ethanol, maybe there's like some amount of hydrogen bonding that would be there. But when you mix ethanol plus water, is it going to be a positive or a negative deviation? I would predict that it's going to be a slightly positive deviation. But let me verify, like theoretically, water may hydrogen bonding, ethanol is going to break that. And ethanol being organic, I would say it's going to cause a little bit of positive deviation. But I will verify that and I'll get back to you guys. Okay. Another example with negative deviation would be take any nonpolar with chloroform, like acetone plus chloroform. Acetone has that oxygen, C double bond O, and chloroform is CHCl3. So the, chloroform may, the dipole moment that's going to be on hydrogen, it's going to have a slightly positive dipole moment because you have like three electronegative chlorine atoms attracting the electrons from the opposite side. So this positive moment is going to bond to the oxygen that is there in acetone. Okay. So individual chloroform may, you won't have that sort of a, it's not going to be as strong as the bond is going to be when it is bonding with acetone. Okay. All right. Here's a question. If I increase the temperature of the solution, so I've got two non-ideal solutions. One has got a positive deviation and one has got a negative deviation. When I increase the temperature of both the solutions, in which case will the solubility increase? In the case of positive deviation or in the case of negative deviation?
In the case of negative deviation.
Why?
Because like if it is a positive deviation, as it is, the solution is trying to, you know, reconstitute into its individual components. So solubility as it is very low. If you increase the temperature, the kinetic energy of individual molecules is going to increase and they're going to want to separate out more. So a positive deviant solution would actually try to revert back to its original components more than a negative deviation.
But
so
the original
solubility there would decrease.
Hmm. But the original components, to start with, they are liquids. Like if they are gases, what the point that you're making makes sense, because you know gases are already have a really high kinetic energy and they can separate out quite easily, which is why we've observed that solubility of gases decreases when you increase the temperature. But in this case, both of them are solutions, like both of them are in the liquid state, and yeah, both their vapor pressures will increase, but both of their vapor pressures are going to increase. Now, how is that going to affect the solubility as such? Because we're talking about liquid state. And focus on this aspect of it. So in the case of positive deviant solutions, delta H, like, is that mixture exothermic or endothermic?
Endothermic.
Sorry, negative deviation, yeah. It's exothermic. It's for negative deviation. So when you increase the temperature, which change is favored? An exothermic change or an endothermic change? So when you're increasing the temperature,
endothermic
is favored, right? Absolutely. So now, do you think solubility of a positive deviant solution is going to increase, or a negative deviant solution is going to increase? Kiska solubility? Positive is going to increase. Yes. Riya has answered correctly. I'm just now looking at the chat here. So that is how you need to figure it out. So when there are gases, Aryan, the argument that you put forward, so that makes complete sense. But since both of them are in the liquid state, just look at, like, when you directly have the relationship between the enthalpy with the formation of the solution, this straight away gives you the idea. As temperature increases, for the positive deviation, solubility increases, and for the negative deviation, solubility decreases. Okay, so these are different aspects of positive and negative deviation of non-ideal solutions. Speaking of, I'd forgotten to mention some examples of ideal solutions. So obviously 100% ideal solutions are practically not possible, but there are solutions that come close. So the deviation is not very large. It is like almost like a straight line. Maybe it comes to be something like this. So what are some examples of ideal solutions? So ideal solutions may actually give me 2 points. So first, let's discuss what should the intermolecular interactions look like in the case of ideal solutions. Abhi, non-ideal may, we've seen that interaction between both the components.
Interaction of AB should be equal to A and AB.
Yeah.
Almost.
Yeah, they should like pretty much be the same. So interaction between A and B should be comparable to the individual interaction between AA or the individual interaction of BB. So all of them should pretty much look like same thing, right? So based on that, can you give some examples of what will form ideal solutions? See, if the intermolecular interaction should remain the same, one, the size and shape of the molecules should be similar, because if, like we have observed, if heavier molecules will show more van der Waals forces as compared to lighter molecules. So if A and B both have comparable sizes and comparable shapes, the likelihood of them having comparable intermolecular this thing should also be the same. And secondly, we saw how presence of dipoles or hydrogen bonding is going to affect the interactions. So if both of them do not have, if both of them do not have any sort of hydrogen bonding at all, or even if they do have some sort of dipoles, if the dipole moment of both A and B is the same, then even if you mix both of them, it's not going to make so much of a difference. So think of it
like
on
carbon disulfide and carbon tetrafluoride.
Carbon disulfide and what's the other one?
CCl4.
Okay.
Because dipole moment is zero.
Yes. Dipole moment is zero, but carbon tetrachloride is like four. It's got a tetrahedral shape. And disulfide has got like a linear shape. So not sure if that would affect their interaction or not. I'll have to look into it. Rhea has given an example, benzene and toluene. Now benzene C6H6 and toluene is C6H6CH3. Again, both of them have got like a ring planar structure. The only difference is the CH3 group, the alkyl group there. Now that's not gonna contribute to any sort of polar interactions. It's mostly in the structure, but practically they're not very different. So that they would form an ideal solution. Another example is N-hexane and N-heptane. Again, hexane, heptane, they differ only by one CH3 group. So that's like what? 12 plus 3. 15 atomic mass units of difference between both the molecules. They are kind of the same thing. Other examples, bromo and chloro. So bromo ethane, bromo chloroethane, bromo benzene, chlorobenzene. Yeah. So species such as these. So Abhinav, as you mentioned, CS2, CCl4, they might form. The only thing I'm not sure of is the shape, because sulfur and chlorine, again, two atoms of sulfur versus four atoms of chlorine, right? So that is the only factor I'm doubtful about, but otherwise, yeah, something on those lines. Yeah. Cool. Now, there is a special case of non-ideal solutions. So non-ideal solutions form something called azeotropes. So azeotropes are basically your normal non-ideal solutions, but at a specific, so obviously at a given temperature, so at a specific concentration, the first thing is, to form an azeotrope, you need the deviation to be large. You need like a really large positive or negative deviation. And the second thing is, basically at a given temperature, like at a particular specific concentration, they are basically binary mixtures having the same composition and boil at a constant temperature.
What do you mean by binary mixtures here?
Binary mixtures, same. Bi means two, so mixture of two components.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah. ठीक है. सो azeotropes आर kind of important. Okay, to understand azeotropes, so when you have a mixture of two components like water plus ethanol, when you boil that mixture, what will happen? Like, what do you observe when you boil any mixture of two liquids? This is something you guys have studied pehle. Like, how do you separate out water, a mixture of water and alcohol?
Distillation.
Yeah, distillation. So what do you do in distillation? Like, what is the basis behind their separation by distillation? Like, what is the principle?
Difference in boiling points.
Difference in boiling point, yes. So what do you do in distillation? Like, how do you make use of this difference in boiling point? So Ananya says,
so the more volatile will get separated out.
So yes, the more volatile is going to get separated out. So what happens is, when you have such a mixture, like separation by distillation means you are going to heat both the liquids. So as the temperature of the solution rises, whichever reaches its boiling point first is going to boil out and get separated from the mixture. And then the other one gets, then if you keep on increasing the temperature, then the other one will reach its boiling point and then you get the vapors of the other one. So that's what happens in your basic distillation, right? But there is a specific concentration. Okay, so this doesn't happen at all concentrations. There is a specific concentration at which they have like a constant composition. Like, so the same composition is in their vapor phase. Okay. No, sorry. They have the same composition in their liquid state, in the solution, and they boil at a constant temperature. It means that when the mixture, if they are in a specific concentration, even if you heat them, both of them boil at the same temperature. So if you have a mixture of water and ethanol, like any other concentration of water and ethanol, ethanol is going to boil first, then you can distill it out and then you can get your water separately. But there is a specific concentration. So this concentration, I believe they've given in your textbook also, when you have like 95% solution of ethanol, both of them boil together, like both of them boil at a constant temperature, at the same temperature, and it becomes impossible to distill, or it becomes impossible to separate both of them by distillation. You will not get both of them separate. You will get mixture of the vapors only at that particular concentration. Okay, so that class of mixture, that kind of solution is called an azeotrope. So azeotropes are important because when you have a mixture that is an azeotrope, it is impossible to separate them out by distillation. Impossible to separate by distillation. So when you're practically doing some sort of a process, like let's say you're manufacturing ethanol and then you get ethanol in a solution, and if you want to obtain pure ethanol from that solution, you need to ensure that it is not at its azeotropic concentration. Because if it happens to be in its azeotropic concentration, you are not going to get pure ethanol. So then, you know, like you need to add some extra water to change the concentration, or do something else, or add some extra ethanol to change the concentration. ठीक है. सो विच इज वाई स्टडीइंग एजियोट्रोप्स एंड फिगरिंग आउट व्हाट इज द एजियोट्रोपिक कॉन्सेंट्रेशन इज वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. Okay, so within azeotropes, now because azeotropes happen when there is a large deviation, you have two different types of azeotropes. You've got a maximum boiling azeotrope and you've got a minimum boiling azeotrope. Okay, so maximum boiling azeotropes, you will observe when it is a solution having a negative deviation, and minimum boiling you will observe when it is a solution having a positive deviation. Okay, so we'll look at it in a theoretical, from a theoretical point of view, like what do the graphs of azeotropes look like and why is there a specific concentration, like where is that coming from. So looking at minimum boiling azeotropes, so you will observe minimum boiling azeotropes for solutions having a large positive deviation. So if this is the ideal, you'll have a really large positive deviation. And of course, you've got your individual stuff here. So this is also going to like have a positive deviation. So maximum boiling azeotropes are characterized by, so at the azeotropic concentration, the vapor pressure, okay. Hi, Jasleen. So we're just talking about azeotropes right now. Huh. So we're talking about minimum boiling azeotropes. At a particular concentration, they are characterized by having maximum total vapor pressure. So this is at a particular concentration. And the boiling point is going to be minimum at this particular maximum total vapor pressure. So okay. The boiling point of solution is minimum at max P total. Okay. Actually, what is the relation between boiling point and vapor pressure of a liquid, of a solution, whatever it may be, because we are going to touch upon this later also. So I just wanted to discuss this with you guys. Yeah. What is the relation between vapor pressure and boiling point? Like, why is the boiling point of a solution getting affected by the vapor pressure? Ritvik is saying inversely proportional. वो तो है, but why is it inversely proportional? Like, logically, what is the relation between them?
So boiling point is basically the temperature at which the vapor pressure is equal to atmospheric pressure.
Yes. So this is like an important point. You can take a note of it. So boiling point is the temperature at which the vapor pressure of a liquid is equal to the atmospheric pressure. Okay, Ritvik Singh, because if vapor pressure is high, then the bonds formed between the molecules are weaker, which means boiling point will be lower. Yes. So inverse proportionality comes from that logic. Awesome. Good stuff, Ritvik. So step one, so boiling point. So basically, when boiling ka matlab, the liquid is changing into vapor state, right? Like liquid is becoming a gas state, which means that the equilibrium that is maintained, so which is what is the vapor pressure, right, should be equal to the atmospheric pressure. That's when the liquid becomes a gas, basically, right? Liquid into gas matlab the vapor pressure, the pressure of the liquid in the gas state, when it is equal to the atmospheric pressure, it means that the liquid itself is turning into gaseous state completely. So boiling point is the temperature at which the vapor pressure of a liquid is equal to the atmospheric pressure. And as the vapor pressure increases, like as you increase the temperature, the vapor pressure increases. It means that the more and more number of molecules are turning into vapor. So as Ritwik said, the intermolecular bonds are weaker than they're going to be in liquids. And hence, the boiling point is inversely proportional to the temperature. So the relation is like inverse. Okay. So now, So coming back to minimum boiling azeotropes. So azeotropes are solutions or are non-ideal solutions. When these non-ideal solutions have a really large positive deviation, there is going to be a specific concentration at which the total vapor pressure of the solution of both the components is going to be at a maximum value. What is happening here? So at this particular concentration, the total vapor pressure is going to be at a maximum value. So at this particular vapor pressure, the boiling point of the solution is going to be at a minimum. And that's why they're called minimum boiling azeotropes. Okay. Similarly, the other type, you're going to have the maximum boiling azeotropes. So where would you observe maximum boiling azeotropes? In what kind of solutions? So minimum boiling positive deviation ke saath hua, to maximum boiling where will you find? Solutions having what?
Negative deviation.
Yes, negative deviation. So solutions having a large negative deviation, there is going to be a particular concentration at which the total vapor pressure is minimum. Okay. So this is the azeotropic concentration at which the total pressure is minimum. And at this particular vapor pressure or at this particular concentration, the solution exhibits a maximum boiling point. Maximum boiling point at this particular concentration, where the solution also has a minimum total vapor pressure. Okay, so this is the maximum boiling azeotrope. And yeah, obviously, so azeotropes are important because like once you know what is the azeotropic concentration, you can, if you want to separate out the components of the solution, then you know to avoid the azeotropic concentration. Otherwise, it would be impossible to separate them out because it's going to like basically boil at that constant temperature. Okay. I have a question here based on azeotropic solutions. Okay. So I have four different solutions here. So solution one is a mixture of chloroform and acetone. Mixture two is a mixture of carbon disulfide and acetone. Mixture three has ethanol and acetone. and mixture 4 has aldehyde and carbon disulfide. So out of this, which one? So like you have all of these azeotropic solutions, which one has a boiling point less than the boiling point of its constituents? So which it will showcase, okay, which has lower boiling point than the boiling point of its constituents? A, B, C, or D? So I'll give you guys like a minute. Think of it and then I'll discuss the answer. Okay, Ria has already, good, your logic is correct. So answer I'll have to check. One moment. Who else? Anyone else answering? Come on, guys. Okay, I'll give you guys a hint. So first think, what kind of a solution do you require? Like what kind of a solution will show a boiling point less than the boiling point of the constituents? Should it have a positive deviation or a negative deviation? Yeah, it should have a positive deviation, right? So Ria, that is where you had gone wrong. But yeah, you need to think of a boiling point. If it should be lower, it means that the vapor pressure should be higher than the individual vapor pressure of the constituents, which means that it should have a positive deviation. Now, which of these four mixtures is showing a positive deviation? Yes. So Jasleen, is it? Yeah, Jasleen has already given a correct answer. So chloroform and acetone, does it show a positive deviation or negative deviation? हमने अभी थोड़ी देर पहले discuss किया था ना? That shows negative. So this is not going to be a correct answer. What about CS2 and acetone? Abhinav also has identified. Good. So CS2 and acetone shows a positive deviation or a negative deviation?
Ideal, I think.
Ideal, nahi. Ye ek mein aaya tha. So CS2 acetone also shows this is an example of a positive deviation. that come up in positive deviation. And ethanol plus acetone. Ethanol plus acetone, also positive. This also shows a positive deviation. And aldehyde and CS2. Yes. Okay. So in this case, which has a lower BP? So both option B and option C. Both of them would be correct. Okay. So these are the kind of questions you can expect related to azeotropic this thing. So you won't be directly asked, okay, which is an example of a maximum boiling or a minimum boiling or things like that. So you need to know how it is relating to its to the changing boiling point and all of these other cases. So it's 10 minutes to 5. I want to finish the chapter. Are you guys available for another half an hour more? So we still have colligative properties left. So relative lowering of vapor pressure and elevation in boiling point, depression in freezing point, all of these things. So are you guys available till, like, can I extend the session till 5:30? Okay, Jasmine says, oh, you guys have open house. Open house for what, FAs? Acha. Okay. How confident are you guys with colligative properties? Because this will have a lot of numericals. So either I can... Okay, so either I can do numericals directly and discuss concept, like one numerical for each concept. We can discuss that quickly, maybe close it out by 5:15. Or we'll have to figure another way out. Maybe continue this in the next class, like first half an hour for this and then do a means. So... yeah, so I just want to know, how are you guys with the colligative properties? Like problems related to it, questions related to it? Are batao na kuch to. Okay, so Aryan has proposed, so you guys practice colligative properties and we can discuss if you guys have any doubts or anything for like 20 minutes to half an hour and then do amines. Jasmine also mentioned it is okay-ish. Okay. All right, I'll quickly revise. I'll just tell you guys the formula and so based on that, you guys can practice problems. If you guys have any doubts, if you're drawing a blank while doing the questions, we'll revisit it. I'll do a revision next class. Otherwise, we can move on with amines. How does that sound? Sounds okay? Okay, cool. I need you guys to reply, man. Like 3-4 people reply and it will obviously be advantageous for them. But if you have a doubt, if you need a revision or like a proper explanation, you need to speak out. Otherwise, you are only going to miss out, no? Okay. Cool. So colligative properties are properties. We had discussed this in case of colloids also. So there are properties that only depend on the concentration of the solution and not on the nature of the solution. Doesn't depend on what your solute is or what your solvent is or anything. It purely depends on how many solute particles you have and how many solvent particles you have, just on the concentration. Okay, So four of the colligative properties. One is relative lowering of vapor pressure. Then you've got elevation and boiling point. So obviously, so if you've if there is a lowering in the vapor pressure, it is going to boil at a higher temperature because it will take more energy to increase that vapor pressure to the atmospheric pressure. So you're going to have elevation in the boiling point, and similarly, you'll have a depression and freezing point or melting point. And the fourth one is osmosis and osmotic pressure. Okay. Now, relative lowering of vapor pressure. So if your original vapor pressure is P naught, the vapor pressure is going to get lowered. What is the relation between your vapor pressure of the liquid? Like we have discussed this pehle, it comes from Raoult's law.
P is equal to X into P naught.
Yeah, X into V naught, where X is the mole fraction of the where X is the mole fraction of the solvent in the liquid. No, wait. So X is the mole fraction of the solvent in the this is the mole fraction of the solvent. So we are looking at lowering of vapor pressure, right? So what will delta P be equal to? So P naught minus P, kyunki the final vapor pressure is lower than your pure, in the pure state. So that'll be equal to P naught minus mole fraction into P naught. That is equal to, P naught into 1 minus mole fraction of the solvent. This can be written as 1 minus X can be written as mole fraction of the solute into P naught. So basically, if you're looking at a relative lowering of lower pressure, so relative matlab, it's going to be ratio. So lowering of vapor pressure with respect to your original, so delta P upon P naught is equal to the mole fraction of the solute. Okay, so this is the relation. So once you have this relation, based on how much, what is the lowering of the vapor pressure, you can find out how much of the solute has been mixed in your solution. So you can find out the mole fraction of the solute. Once you have the mole fraction, you'll be able to find out the number of moles and then the molar mass of the solute that has been mixed in it. Okay. Similarly, there's going to be elevation of boiling point. Abhi discuss kiya humne ki if the vapor pressure has been lowered, you're going to have to spend more energy in covering the deficit of the lower, like the vapor pressure, right? So if this is the atmospheric, or let me just draw it here. So let's say this is the atmospheric pressure. Originally, this was the vapor pressure of the pure liquid. But on mixing the solvent, vapor pressure has become lower. So this has become P. So you like initially, if you take water as an example, you need to heat up water to 100 degrees Celsius to cover up, go from vapor pressure at any temperature to the atmospheric pressure. But if you have a solution, if you mix like some sort of salt or sugar in water, vapor pressure is lowered, which means that you need to spend more energy. So basically heat it at a higher temperature for it to reach atmospheric pressure, for water to boil. So obviously there has been an elevation and boiling point. And this elevation and boiling point, there is a relation. So elevation and boiling point delta TB is directly proportional to the molality of the solute. and removing the proportionality sign, you've got delta TB. This is the elevation and boiling point is equal to KB into the molality of the solution. So molality of the solute in the solution, where KB is a constant. And yeah, so the constant is called ebullioscopic constant or the molal boiling point elevation constant. So this you guys can learn. All right. And similarly, depression and freezing point also follows a similar format. So delta TF is also directly proportional to the molality. So now, because this is dealing with freezing, so the relation, the constant also changes to the cryoscopic constant, KF into M, where M is the molality. Okay, so this you guys need to be careful about. And there is a way to find out what KB and KF are. So that is related to your original freezing point and the enthalpy of fusion or the enthalpy of vaporization, depending on what the process is. So this basically KB, sorry, small b, boiling, is equal to R, which is the gas constant, into M, which is the molar mass of the solvent, into TB square is the boiling point in absolute, like in Kelvin, into 1000 into delta H vaporization. This is the enthalpy of vaporization. And similarly, KF also can be calculated. So instead of boiling point and enthalpy of vaporization, you will have freezing point and enthalpy of fusion. So R into M into TF square upon 1000 into delta H fusion. Yeah. So these are the colligative properties. So the kind of questions you'll be asked are mainly something like, you'll be given the relative, like, so the vapor pressure was measured to be so-and-so value, and you'll be given the vapor pressure of the original liquid, and you might be asked to find out, oh, how much of the solute has been mixed in the solution. Or maybe you'll be asked the other way around, wherein you'll be given that, oh, 5 grams of sugar was dissolved in so many ml of water. Given that your vapor pressure of water was pure water is so and so value, what will be the vapor pressure of the solution when this much solute is dissolved? And you'll be given, if with respect to elevation or depression in freezing point also, it'll be the same thing. Ria is asking, M is the molar mass of solute or solvent. In this case, calculation of KB, KF values, M is the molar mass of the solvent. So these are constants of, like, these are constants, right? So it would be the molar mass of the solvent. Again. And this 1000 is coming from, like, if you take the molar mass, it's usually expressed in grams. But since everything is in SI units, to convert it to SI units, you're including this 1000 also here in the denominator. Okay. Cool. So I'll assign some questions for you guys. I'll see if you need some more practice, I'll find out questions from other sources also. Yeah, so practice the problems, and if there's any doubts, we'll catch up this weekend, either on Friday and Saturday. And we'll have an extra class on Saturday for sure. I might take it for 3 hours. So I originally talked about it at the beginning of the class. I hope, like, are all of you guys free on Saturday? I have had confirmation from 4 or 5 of you. What about the rest?